Oh, but wait for the semantic web. And so what is the semantic web? What does that mean? And what does it mean to me as a user?
Okay, it's about, like I said, it's about understanding the concepts. When you have 500 word text, it's about understanding the phrase.
Okay, folks, we'll have
Product
the audio
manufactured
back.
by
Here we
Apple
go.
compared to Granny Apple. So that's the difference, really, being able to understand concepts rather than simple keyword matches.
But so is it just limited to search, or is it the way you
No,
interact when
it's
you
going to
go
be,
online
well,
anytime?
and how people are going to use semantic web, it's going to be a, you know, it's going to be huge in terms of how we're going to use it. I can't possibly figure out how we're going to use it right now. But there's going to be many applications of semantic web, i.e., being able to understand being able to understand what is being said. You know, when I say you know, Apple iPod again, it's about not a Granny Smith's Apple, but it's about Apple iPod as an application. That basic difference is very important in the way that we digest information on internet.
Kim, go ahead.
Okay, here's the real one, guys. I have a 10-year-old daughter. Her friends are starting to pop up all over my Facebook, and I will not allow my daughter to have Facebook. I don't know when the right time is. I don't know how I can protect her, or how any of us, any parent, can protect a child when using the internet. So what kind of advice do you have for that?
You know, that I have a 6-year-old who goes on Google and finds games. He hasn't started doing Facebook yet, but I'm sure it's going to be very soon. So I share the same problems, actually. You know, I have no idea how I can protect my kids from the unknown, the unauthenticated. I just want them to be able to see what is good. But unless you have the difference of what is good, what is bad, what are good people, what are bad people, who are disguising as a kid but not a kid, but who are actually his friends or her friends, that basic authentication doesn't exist. Until we put it, we're not going to be able to protect our kids, unfortunately. And that is very, very important. We have to, because internet is not getting any less in terms of adoption. It's getting more and more. When you were 6-year-old, when we were 6-year-old, we did not have internet. Our kids have internet now, and they use it. And it's becoming, you know, my 3-year-old is going to be using internet more than my 6-year-old, because in 3 years' time, internet is going to be in a different world altogether. So how do we protect these people? We need to be able to, if we want to give them good stuff, you first have to identify what is good stuff.
And how much of that is technology versus educating your children? Because as I understand it, I mean, part of the problem now is it's not so much that your child goes online and somebody is pretending to be somebody else, but they simply pretend to be someone who sounds
You don't have
like a nice
kids.
person. No, I do, absolutely, and
Six
I'm
year
very
old.
worried
All
about it.
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
No,
Six year
I
old.
understand. But
So.
yeah, kids, I'm sure that from what I understand, it's that a lot of their friends will be using it in a certain way, and someone will come into the group and say, "Hey, I'm such and such," and sooner or later you'll find out it's some 40-year-old pretending to be a 12-year-old, and so forth. I mean, is that the sort of thing that technology solves, or is it the
No,
sort of
absolutely.
thing that we start to educate our children about what can happen?
Education is always going to be there and always needed. However, there is a technological component that we have to start putting in. We can simply enable schools with digital certificates so that they can identify themselves to each other. So that we can have an IM, an instant messaging or Facebook kind of application with a digital certificate built in that the teachers could enable their kids with. That way we know that my sons or your daughter's friends are always going to be authenticated using their digital certificate. Very simple process, but it's a lot of hard work to put it in place. So the technology is there already today. Instant messaging, Facebook is there, digital certificates there. Browsers can handle digital certificates. Email clients can handle digital certificates. We just need to get the instant messaging applications and Facebook to handle the digital certificates, and then you have authentication.
So the issue is Facebook at this point.
Not just Facebook, instant messaging applications, anything that connects us apart from emails and browsers need to start utilizing digital certificate technologies. But then even when you've done that, you still have to go to schools and start setting up processes whereby they can enable their kids with a digital certificate. So that, you know, when my son is talking to his friends online, or when, you know, Kim's daughter talking to someone online, they can identify that person as belonging to that school or part of their friends. Today, they have no means to be able to do that.
Right. And so what is that? Is that going out in part to Facebook and saying, look, you have to do this for the safety of our kids and so forth? Is it
everyone. I think, you know, schools, Facebook, everyone. It's now, we're all demanding that, you know. So we need to unite as a voice. There is no standard, there is no organization that I can go to and say, hey, please make that happen. Internet is such a new area, and connectivity is such a new area. There is no single organization I can go to and demand that. So who's going to do that? You know, we all have the responsibility to go to our schools and demand it, you know, and let's hope that there's going to be companies going to be coming up with technologies that will make that easier for us to adopt.
Great. Let's take one more question from Boaz, and then we'll take a break.
All righty. We have Scott in New York, who's not on cam, but in voice.
Go ahead, Scott.
Hello, sir. Thanks for taking my question. I was just curious. I mean, I'm kind of wondering if you could sort of give some examples of maybe sort of how this new semantic web would work, maybe for a specific service like PalTalk, the service that we all sort of know and love. I mean, do you think if PalTalk had more semantic web-based features, then how would it be different? Would we see ads that we liked more, or would we see rooms that we thought were cooler, or do you think we would be, you know, warned of more malicious users or something like that? I'm trying to envision how it might apply for PalTalk.
There are two things in semantic web: authentication and understanding, you know, what you want, with, you know, like query and this and that. So for rooms, if you were to write what your interest was, semantic web would give you a better match to the rooms that are available. Or semantic web could understand the chat that is happening in PalTalk, for example. You know, people are typing right now. What are they typing about? Semantic web would understand that and would alert you perhaps immediately, saying, hey, there is something interesting happening that you might be interested in. Today, it cannot understand. It'll just be word and keywords. I might be using a word that might be interest to you, but not in the concept, not in the subject that you're interested in. So it will help you understand the talks that are happening or the rooms are happening, and it will better match your needs to use PalTalk.
Great. Let's take a break. We'll be back in a few minutes. Thanks.
Interactive two-way conversation for the world via the internet. This is PalTalk. It's like having your very own two-way radio talk show, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's like having a party line conversation with friends from all around the world. It's like, well, really cool. Just log on to www.paltalk.com. Simply sign up. Sign up. Download. Download the software. Then get ready for your voice to be heard by the